now tuned in to Conversations with Cogee. You dig? It's Conversations with Cogee. It's Conversations. The boy is about to float. Stay tuned.
It's Conversations, baby. Yeah, I'm doing my thing. Come and sit down. Call and talk to me. Topics off the chain. Yeah, I'm getting it in. Callers calling in. Jamming up my system. Stay tuned to my show and make sure you're listening. Make sure you're listening. You want to make sure you're listening.
Yo, what's up, everybody? It's your boy, Coach. I'm back. Hey, we in the third hour right now, and I know it's what everybody been waiting on, Miss Mary Jo Buttafuoco. She'll be in soon in a minute. So, Miss Megan.
Yes.
So you still on here, I see. Holding on, ready to bring it. Give me one more before you go. I know you got to hurry and get back to work, and I appreciate you giving me this moment. But drop a little bit more science before you go real quick.
Don't think you can change a person. If they want to change, they will make the change. But you, too, have to make the change within yourself before you try to enter into a relationship.
You're definitely right on that. But, you know, I think with the change, the woman's got to be able to work with the guy. The guy's got to be able to work with the woman through the change, too. Right or wrong?
Well, you know what? I mean, sometimes you can get help from outside to make that change, or sometimes people can make that change within themselves, you know, but they have to want to make the change.
Right, but see,
you know, you
go ahead.
You can't force someone to change if they don't want to. But you have to ask yourself if you're happy with that. I mean, if you can live with it, fine, by all means. I don't knock nobody for it.
But you also can't turn to every friend for advice.
And that's very true, because they're not professionals.
Right. But then there's some friends that can't even handle their own business. I know people that go and ask their friends stuff, and then they see their friend's life is upside down. Of course, they're going to give you something negative. I try to say something, you know, give you some advice, but they don't even follow it. You know, I believe in, you know, I can follow somebody. I see in them leading what they're saying. You know what I'm saying?
Absolutely. You know, my dad has this saying, you know, your home may be ready for them, but is their home ready for you?
You're definitely right. You know, and my daddy had one, too. Mind your own business. You know what I'm saying? For real, because it's like, hey, I can't tell none of these guys on this panel what their household is like with their wives or their girlfriends. You know what I'm saying? Because I'm not there. And one thing I do know is two sides to every story.
Yeah.
So I'd rather
say there's three sides. There's their side, and in between, that's the real side.
Right. Yeah, you're right about that. But I'd rather just say to them, hey, man, look, I support you, man. You work it out however you got to deal with it. And, hey, I got your back. You know what I'm saying? Because at the end of the day, I'm not going to feel your pain when I lay in the bed at night.
Absolutely.
You know what I'm saying?
Absolutely.
Right.
Absolutely.
So I want to thank you for being on here today. You always do a great job, as usual.
Oh, and thank you. You know, I'm going to keep supporting you. I think what you're doing is fabulous. Keep up the good work, and I'm here always.
All right, thank you. And you know, we got a hot show coming up, but don't say nothing. and you know, right, I know you're going to throw down on that one. So, hey, they'll be hearing from you again, all right?
Oh, absolutely.
Okay. Thank you very much. And you take it easy. Hey, kiss the baby for me, all right?
I will.
Okay, take it easy. All right, bye-bye. Mr. Smooth, you want to sign out real quick, and then we got to keep it moving. What's your advice to the men?
I think one of the things that I didn't want to see, you know, I close my eyes to a lot of stuff, and I just say out there to the fellas, open your eyes up, open your eyes.
There it is. So, this is what we're going to do, everybody, before we bring a special person on the mic right now, who's sitting here looking cute and sassy and got the summer colors on for us. We're going to bring her in for a minute, but I want to kind of give y'all a little background on her, and, you know, we'll play this, and then we're going to come back in, but we got a song that kind of matches all this situation, and we're going to let her roll from her. All right? You're listening to Conversations with Cogee. Do not touch that dial. You're going to miss something big, all right? This is something you're going to talk about with your friends, so just hold on, we'll be right back.
That's just how you live. Oh, take it all, but you never give. Should have known you was trouble from the first.
And now back to Conversations with Cogee.
All right, we back in. It's your boy Cogee. Hey, we ain't gonna wait no longer. Miss Mary Jo Buttafuoco, how you doing?
Well, that was quite an appropriate song for the occasion.
So, what'd you think about that?
That could have been my life 20 years ago.
Right. because the reason why I wanted to play is because even though you got shot, you still stayed with this man after that situation.
You know, I was listening to Donna earlier, and I'm friendly with her. I went to her for a lot of advice on her love fraud thing because I did not understand until 3 years ago what a sociopath was.
Right.
In my case, you know, it goes way back. We were 16 years old when we met. And this is, I hate to say this, 35, 40 years ago. 40 years ago, yipes. And these conversations never came out. There was no internet. There was no cell phones. There was no, you know, what we have now, what did not exist. It was like the dark ages. So Joe and I met in high school, and if you recall your high school years, most of us were pretty stupid and self-centered and self-absorbed anyway. So that... Am I wrong? I mean, but as the years went on, and we got married, and we had kids, and he still was behaving like a child, right, which I thought was childish behavior, I just kept thinking, when is he going to grow up? That was the thing. And then, unfortunately, he became addicted to cocaine for 10 years in our marriage, the first 10 years of our marriage. And I realize now, again, that that masked the sociopathy that he had. In other words, he was a coke addict. He would disappear for days on time. At a time, I had these two little children. I had this, you know, we were talking about earlier what things our parents told us. My parents told us exactly that. Mind your own business. Don't tell anybody your problems. If you've got problems, they belong to you. Now, this dad, they're going back 60 years. So you were going generational. What it is now is not the same. It's not what I would teach my kids. So it's like this whole thing goes on, and I didn't feel I could tell anybody. I didn't want, I was ashamed. I was embarrassed. I didn't want to, I made this picture perfect life with these picture perfect kids and this picture perfect house. And I smiled my way through a nervous breakdown and panic attacks because I was ashamed. And finally, after 10 years of marriage, when I said to Joe, you know, I can't put up with this anymore. I'm going to leave. He went into rehab. Like, he did go into rehab.
So he was trying to save the marriage.
Yes, yes. Okay. And he, every time was, I'm sorry, I love you, it'll never happen again, you can't leave me, what'll I do without you, crying, very, you know, it's very touching for a woman, I can't do it without you, I can't live without you.
But let me ask you this question, how shocked were you when you found out about Amy Fisher? after like you
Buying.
Said, after like you said, making this life where you thought it was this and it's picture perfect, how...
Well, Amy Fisher didn't come into my life till 15 years into our marriage. So I had gone through the 10 years of drug abuse. Then he got sober, and I thought, hooray, it's all good.
Here
this
we
is
go.
It. This this was the tiger. This was the, you know, the monkey on our back. He's gone. And we had a couple of good years. Unbeknownst to me, once the drug went away, then the illness manifested itself even more.
Into something else.
Right. And then it was lying about everything. And he was such a good liar. I mean, everything had a story, everything. And when I would say when I'd say for the millionth time, I'm out of here, I can't do this anymore, he would then say to me, you know that song Lou Rawls had, You'll Never Find Another Love Like
Mine?
Yeah,
right.
He would say that, you know that song, Mary Jo? That's it. You're never going to find anybody who's going to love you the way I do. And played on my insecurities, played on my fears, played on it all. And I bought into it.
But doing that, like you said, when you found out about...
Well, I found out about Amy Fisher when I woke up in the hospital. That's how... I never knew that they
Wow, I never knew. You never knew nothing about it.
Oh, not a thing. That's how good he was. Not a thing. I never had a clue. I never had an inkling. I never had a thought about it. I answered my door one day in May of 1992. I was in the backyard painting. I lived in a little suburban, nice little neighborhood. And I'm painting, and the doorbell rings, and I can see through the house. And there's a teenager out the outside in the front. There's a kid out there. So I don't hesitate. It's 12 o'clock on a Tuesday afternoon. The sun is shining. Cars are driving by. Lawnmowers are going. There's no reason for me to think anything's wrong.
Right.
I go to the front. I thought she wanted to sell Girl Scout cookies or something. Go to the door, and I say, yeah, what can I do for you? And she says, are you Mrs. Buttafuoco? She said, yeah. She goes, I need to talk to you about your husband, Joey. Okay. I pushed open the door. I stood outside. I had this little porch, this little two-step stoop.
Right.
I leaned on one side. She leaned on the other. And I said, what can I do for you? And she said, I want to let you know that your husband is having an affair with my little sister.
Mm.
And tell, I, you know, I just dropped. I just dropped. Like, you know, like, I couldn't comprehend what you, what? And I said, your little sister, that was my first thing to her. I was like, I looked at her, she looked like she was 12.
What age was this, the little sister?
There is no little sister.
Oh, okay.
Found that she out was after just, the fact,
right, okay. She just was holding your attention.
Yeah.
Right.
And I looked at her, and to me, she looked like she was 14 years old. So I'm going, your little sister, like a dope, that's what I said.
Right.
I said, how old are you? And she goes, I'm 19 years old. And I said, really? And how old is your little sister? And she goes, 16. And I said, what's your name? She did. I started questioning her. I went into this mother mode where it's like this little kid, and I could tell she's lying because she's getting all nervous and jumpy. Yeah. But I don't know why. I had no inkling. There was no threat to my life. I never saw a gun. I just thought, who is this pain in the rear end kid coming up here? You're saying this to me. I actually thought to myself, what did Joey do now? I thought that to myself. This is like just a little, but there was no fear. I had no sense of that anything was going to happen to me.
Right.
And we talked for about a minute and a half, and she told me I asked her where she lived, and she went like this, and she said a name of a street. And I knew in my head that street's on the other side.
Okay.
Just all this little stuff. So finally, like I said, a minute and a half goes by, and I said, look, Anne-Marie, I don't know what you want me to do about this, but I'm going to go in the house. I'm going to call Joe and tell him you came by. Thanks for coming. Like an idiot, I said, thanks for coming by, like a dope. I'm telling you, Cogee, I turned my head to the right. I opened the screen door, and that was the end of my life as I knew it. It was over. I felt this explosion in the side of my head. I went back and down. My last conscious thought was, where did she get the baseball bat? Like, that's what I thought I had been hit with.
Oh,
like,
wow.
I just felt this boom into my head, and I went back. Next thing I know, I wake up 3 days later in the hospital. The police are all over me because nobody knows what has happened. They assumed that I was being attacked because my paintbrush was in the backyard and everything was in the back. You could see I was in the middle of a bench. It was half painted.
Right.
And this happened in the front of the house, and they assumed that maybe some man came to attack me, and I ran to the front, and this is what happened. I mean, this whole big thing. And I woke up, and I had a trach tube in me, and I couldn't speak, and they were yelling at me to wake up, and do I know who did this to me? And I'm like, yeah, it was that girl Anne-Marie. And finally the trach tube came out. I was in a coma for 3 days, so they had no idea. And when they said to me, I couldn't speak, so I went like this, because I knew it was that kid. That was the last thing I remember.
Right.
And I wrote things down on this yellow legal pad that said, Anne-Marie, 19 years old, T-shirt, because she'd given me a complete auto body T-shirt. And that was the beginning of the end. And then when they looked at me and said, a girl? I'm like, yeah, it was a kid. A kid shot me in the head, a girl. They were blown away. And so it was, they somehow, when they said Anne-Marie, I this T-shirt was the clue, because Joey had given one of these T-shirts to Amy Fisher because her car was being repaired.
Right.
And that was the thing that got it, because when they said the T-shirt, he said, I've only given out one of those T-shirts, and it was to Mr. Fisher's daughter.
Oh,
and they said, who's Mr. Fisher's daughter? And he said, Amy Fisher. And they said, who's Amy Fisher? And they brought me a picture. You know, hours went by. And I said, that's her. And it just went ballistic. It became...
And even landing in the hospital, you still didn't know right off the bat that it was a gunshot and it wasn't a bat?
Oh, well, by the time I woke up, they were yelling at me, you've been shot.
Okay,
like, they
do
that when they're trying to bring you into consciousness.
Yeah.
They want to tell you what happened to you.
Right.
So they were yelling, you've been shot.
Hmm.
And I'm going, did I hear that? I was shot? You know, I couldn't believe it. Like, I didn't see a gun. I wasn't threatened with anything. So, yeah, that's how I found out. I couldn't believe it. I just was like, it took a long time for that to even register.
So how was Joey at the hospital? You dealing with this?
Oh, he was by my side. I mean, the kid, I mean, it was just
awful.
Was
he in denial? Or did he come clean?
He said, I know who that is. That's Amy Fisher. I fix her car. I fix her parents' car.
Oh,
she's in our shop all the time. I never had anything to do. I mean, I fixed her car. Like, that was his story. I fixed her car. I knew her. I've talked to her. I've seen her. She's been in our shop 1,000 times. My father knows her. My brother knows her, because this was a family auto body shop. And My father-in-law and brother-in-law at the time said, yeah, we know who she is. The family's in there all the time. And then she started with the, he told me to kill her. And that was not so.
Right.
But that was her defense,
right,
if you will. That was the lawyer's defense. He made me do it, kind of a thing. But he just stuck to his story that he never had sex with her. He never had anything to do with her other than fix her car and talk to her the way you and I are talking, a customer.
Right.
I met you, we're talking, hello, goodbye. That's it. And he stuck to it. And now, all these years later, you know, I would think to myself, out of guilt, could you imagine if you were screwing around? You don't mean for your wife to get killed, but then this
right.
happens.
Yeah.
The guilt should have killed him enough alone. But I realize now, sociopaths don't feel guilt.
Right.
So they get on their high horse and go, wasn't me. I didn't do it. I had nothing to do with it. I had, nothing to say about it.
But what do you think got so detrimental in their relationship? You think it got so deep that she wanted you out of the way?
Okay. What it was this. I think he took advantage of this young girl. She was a call girl. We all know what she's doing now. She's a pole
right.
dancer. She's
yeah.
a stripper. She's a porn star. Okay.
Right.
This is not a surprise. She was like this, unfortunately, when she was a teenager. She's a victim of sexual abuse as a child.
Right.
And I think she's looking for love in all the wrong places.
Okay.
You know, that's a whole nother story.
Right.
And I think she came on to him, and I think his ego liked this. She was 16. She was 5 weeks short of her 17th birthday. She was no regular 16-year-old. I had 2 16-year-olds, and I have 3 stepchildren that I've seen 16. They don't look like she looked. She was, you know, she had that aura, the hot shorts,
yeah.
the low tops.
Yeah.
I mean, she looked very sexual even
She
then.
Was already seasoned.
Yeah.
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 In a nice
so,
way of saying it.
So, you know, it's very easy.
Right.
She came on to him. He's a 36-year-old man. He's been married for 15 years. Whatever it was, he had a fling, okay? He finally says, you know, he's not going to marry her. He doesn't want a relationship. It was a fling. To him, it was nothing. To her, it was, I want this man.
Right.
And the thing that's standing between me and this man is his wife.
Hmm.
And I believe that is what she did this on her own. She tried more than once to kill me. She hired 2 other people to kill me. I write about it in my book.
Oh, wow.
She was stalking me for 9 months before I was shot. And she did hire 2 other people. It's documented. They came forward. You know, this is not a story that I'm telling.
Right.
The problem is a lot of people don't know about this because there was no trial, because she took a plea deal. And it just was an awful, I look back now talking about, you know, how do you get through things? I don't know. I sit here almost 20 years later and I don't have an answer to that, how I got through it. I almost didn't. There was more than one time that I just wanted to kill myself. I wanted to take my kids and sit in my car and put a hose in my car and just turn on the gas because it was too painful to live.
Right.
But you get through that. I'm Catholic. I believe in God. I just knew, like, I survived this. For some people, don't survive what I survived.
You're right. But did Joey, during that ordeal, when you said you wanted to give up and you wanted to kill yourself, did he try to embrace you? I try to get you to hold on. I try
oh, yeah.
to get you to shake out of it.
Mm-hmm. He was the most supportive man. When this happened, he took a leave of absence from work, 5 months, stayed home with me, took care of those kids, fed them, bathed them, made their breakfast, made their lunch, took them to school. My hero. I'm suffering. He did everything for me.
Right.
Everything. Loved me, told me how much he loved me, and he couldn't believe he almost lost me. He's very good. He's got a good rap.
But did he seem like he wanted the marriage to stay strong, I mean, and solid?
Oh, yeah. There was never a talk about a divorce or leaving each other.
Wow.
The assumption was this crazy girl became obsessed with Joe, and she tried to kill me to get me out of the picture. That was his story.
But
I knew her, but I had nothing to do with it.
But did you go through the, you know, a person just keep playing something back in their head like, but why would she do that?
Yeah.
I mean, did you drill him to death?
That's I drilled him to death.
Where it never stopped. Like, okay, you know, even on y'all good days, y'all could be having good days and you'll fire right back up. You know what I'm saying?
Yes.
How long did you go through that?
Till I divorced him.
Oh, wow. Oh, wow.
Pretty much. But yeah, I think that put the wedge in. I couldn't understand then why would she do this. And he, I don't know, she's crazy, she's out of her mind, she's a psycho, and it never, our marriage was never the same. It just never was. I was looking for an answer that I, to this day, I realize now I'm never going to get. It's never going to happen. You know, she's out of her mind. She still is. He's a liar. He always will be. So I've had to learn to make peace with this and say, you know what? It happened. It is what it is.
Wow. So when you and her finally got to talk, have y'all got to talk like straight one-on-one over a phone, even in the courtroom? What did she say after, as time went on? Did she feel like she was a fool for doing it and it wasn't worth him and what her life was going through?
That saga started in 1999. Okay, I'd been shot in 92 and it was 1999 and my lawyer called me up and said, Amy Fisher's mother wants to meet with you.
Oh, wow.
Now, Amy Fisher's mother and me are the same age.
Okay.
And Amy wants to apologize. And for 7 years, I never heard, I'm sorry. I never heard, I made a mistake. And I thought, oh, wow. You know, she's growing up. She's getting it. She's sorry. Her mother wants to see me. So, again, being the schmuck that I am or nice person, whatever you want to call it, I was like very open to it. I was very receptive to it.
Right.
And I did. I was living in California. I was still married to Joe. And I went and met with her mother, and her mother shared with me that she had been sexually abused as a child, which, you know, doesn't take a rocket science to figure that one out. But the mother confirmed a lot of things to me. And so I asked the mother, why didn't you leave when Amy was a little girl? Because the father was very abusive. It was the father.
Right.
And she said, I did leave. I did leave, and I went to my parents. Now, the mother is very Italian. The father was Jewish, and the mother's Italian.
Okay.
And she went to her parents, and her parents, old school Italian from the 30s and the 40s, said, you made your bed, you lied.
Hold on.
We told you not to marry him. That's out of your faith. He's a Jew. We told you not to. And they brushed her off. So this young woman now doesn't have the support of her family, goes back to the abuser, and stays. And stayed with him until I got shot, you know, then their marriage broke up. But
wow, that was devastating. But how did you feel when you seen this, when y'all seen each other face to face?
I had harbored a great deal of anger towards the mother because I thought, how, you had one kid, your only child, and you screwed her up. Look at this, look at what she did. She ruined my life. She came into my, I have kids and I would never, you know, I had this like attitude about it. And I was really angry. I was angry for a lot of years.
Right.
And then when I met her, I looked at her and I realized she was suffering as much as I was. This woman didn't plan this. Right. She didn't want this.
It shook her life up too.
Yeah. Right. And as a mom, and my kids were older by this time. By this time, my son had was 16 and I started to see I had teenagers now, whereas when I got shot, they were little.
Okay.
And my heart softened a little. And then that whole thing went down, and then I spoke with Amy Fisher, and I had correspondence from jail. She wrote to me about how sorry she was, and it was a big, you know, she can't believe she did this, and she's paying for it, and she lives.
Did she want you to drop the case?
Oh, no, the case was, she was in jail. It was not to drop the case.
Right. Well, you know, just to kind of have a little
bit of mercy. She was coming up for parole.
Right. Oh, that's bingo. Yeah.
You got Cogee. You got it.
Right.
You got, and guess what? Sucker. Right. Sucker. I fell for it. I went to New York. She went up for parole. Got her released early. I know. And because I thought, I know.
Can I say this? Can I say this? Okay. I think when things like, I ain't going to go there, y'all.
I'm gonna
keep it cool. I think when things like it happen and somebody deliberately do that to you that bad, I think when you let them go that easy, I think that shows society it's okay to do it. Because if I can talk to this person and get them to drop it.
I know you what you're going to say, and I hear you. Let me just say this. She had got a 5 to 15 year sentence. She had served 7 years. She was getting out anyway. It wasn't like I forgave her.
Right.
I forgave her because I needed, you don't, the anger and the
I hear you.
I became addicted to Percocet and Xanax.
I hear you.
So this journey that I was on,
I
had to forgive her to start letting go of this.
Okay.
Now, you're right. You're right what you're saying. Like, it made it sound like, well, sure, no big deal. You came to my house, you shot me. Oh, no, that's not why I forgave. I forgave for me because I was being eaten up alive with my hate.
And I understand
and
that. Me and you talked about that. But the point I'm saying is I just want our listeners out there to understand and don't take us the wrong way. That's why me and you had to kind of come back and clear it up
for everybody. What do you say?
We had No. Me and you have to clear it up for people out there to let them know that's listening over the airwaves that you don't let nobody just get away with that easy.
Of course not. Right, she was in jail for 7 years.
Okay,
she
right.
She was going to get out.
That's the part they didn't know.
And
she
what
was
they
already
also didn't know
years.
Is when I was in the district attorney's office, she got 4 years of hard parole.
Okay.
This was a girl who had a curfew at 7 o'clock every night, 24, 25 years old.
Okay.
She was drug tested. She couldn't go or do anything. She had to get a job. And I thought to myself at the time, good, let her try to figure out. I mean, it was easy in jail. You're sitting in there and somebody's feeding you 3 meals a day. Come on out and live on Long Island, being Amy Fisher. You'll see how hard it is.
Yeah, that right.
And I honestly at the time thought, she'll never make it. She won't make it. She's crazy. She's an animal. She's never going to make it. She surprised me. She made it. She never got into trouble again.
Right.
You know, with as far as the law.
Where did she get the gun from?
It turns out she went to Brooklyn and bought it, some illegal street gun from some guy that she gave sex to.
Oh, wow.
She gave
a sex pistol.
And $400. And that's what it cost for my life.
Oh, wow.
Mm-hmm. And the dope 19-year-old kid said, hey,
right.
You know, he didn't think she was going to do it.
Right.
He thought, she's crazy. You know, oh, she's not going to.
But did anybody ever come up? The guy that sold her the gun? Did they find
him?
They
found him.
Bingo.
And he got 6 months in jail. Cogee, my story is.
He got 6 months in jail?
He drove her to my house. He changed the license plates on her car.
Oh, wow.
He watched her shoot me. He drove away with her. He took her bloody clothes and the gun and disposed of it in a drain pipe on the street.
Oh, wow.
And he got 6 months. That's a whole nother story, how badly I was abused by the legal system.
And you know what? We're going to get right back into that. But, wow.
After I hang myself, we'll be right back.
I am blown away. You know what? You told me earlier today was more layers to just this of what we're talking about today. And, you know, me and you definitely got to finish this again because, like I said, they only gave him 6 months for what he done changing.
Isn't that called conspiracy to murder?
Yeah, that's conspiracy. Bingo, that's conspiracy to murder. You're definitely right.
Okay. I could explain that, too, real fast. Okay.
Wow, that's what we're going to do. Everybody, hold on. We're going to take a break, and we're going to digest this for a minute. You know what I'm saying? But, hey, I know y'all want to hear the rest of this because we're going to the wire with, man, Miss Butterfuko, I got love for you. You done been through a lot. You're a soul survivor for real, and I mean that. So, everybody, hold on. This is Conversations with Cogee, and we'll be right back. You don't want to miss this. Don't touch that dial, all right? We'll be right back.
Welcome to Conversations with Cogee, the show where it's always hot and we keep the truth coming. We support great causes and we stand for something strong. If you want to be a part of us, check out the conversationswithcogee.com website for more information and upcoming shows. And keep us on your radar. And you want to be a part of us because we're making a movement all around the world, city to city. Conversations with Cogee, baby. Join up as me and the Conversation with Cogee team take it to the top. Check us out.
Conversations with Cogee.
What's up, everybody? We back. Conversations with Cogee, man. This is going to the wire. Hey, this is just getting more hot. I mean, even more than came out on the break, and we're going to get to it in a second. Let's go to a phone call. Conversations with Cogee.
Hey, Coach.
Hey, what's up, buddy? So you've been listening to the story?
Man, whoo. Boy, that's a strong woman.
A real strong woman.
Or stupid. I'm not quite
that
sure.
That is a strong woman.
Thank you, dear.
Oh, man. Hold on. I want you to hold on, Alan, man. We got to jump back into this real quick because our time is coming down.
Yeah.
And with this next story, go ahead and tell what you said on the break.
Okay. You know, again, this is so it was so complicated. I really became a victim of the legal system. You know, everything that I was raised to believe just crashed at my feet. And what happened was this. When this all came down, that this is a 17-year-old girl and it's Amy Fisher and the police are going crazy, they can't believe it, and the media is getting a hold of it. When they finally picked Amy Fisher up, the police, they brought her down to headquarters. And this is in Nassau County, Long Island, a little podunk town. Things don't happen like this in Nassau County. So I don't think they had any idea how to deal with this. So they brought her in for questioning, and it took them 12 hours to break her down to finally admit she did this. But in those 12 hours, her parents called and reported her missing because she was underage and she was gone, and they reported her as a missing person. They had her in custody in the back, and they just told the parents, oh, okay, you know, they took the report down. And another thing, they never told her about her rights. They never got her a lawyer. She was under age 18. So they fouled up to begin with. So by the time justice should have been served, they needed to cover their own rear ends. And that means we're not putting her on trial for attempted murder, which is exactly what it was. We let her plead guilty down to one count of assault. No, they had charges, deadly weapon, murder. I mean, they had like six or seven big charges against her, down to one count of aggravated assault. And the gentleman who drove her to my home and witnessed her shoot me and drove away and brought her home and took her bloody clothes and the gun and threw them down a drain area on a side street somewhere.
Right.
When they finally got him, because this couldn't go to trial,
okay,
they allowed him to plead guilty to 6 months in county jail for obstruction of justice or some ridiculous thing.
But
like
what
that.
Did your attorney say? Why didn't your attorney pull him in? Like, no, that's, you know, that's being a part of a murder. Why wouldn't your attorney so?
You know, this is what I found out. I found out that the criminal justice system is a business. It's not about justice.
Right.
It's a business. And you have no say. You are the people. The people versus, they rule the roost. The district attorney's office decides what comes, what goes. Don't believe CSI and law and order and all that stuff. It's a business. We got to get them in and get them out. Get them in and get them out. Why do we have what we have going on in the world today?
Well, we got a phone call right now. This person says he believes it's chemical imbalance. Mr. Ron McCormick, how you doing today, sir?
Good, buddy. How you doing?
I'm doing all right. So, Ron, tell us about what you said. You think it might be a chemical situation in the brain as far as health.
You know what? Unfortunately, in this country, we've had malnutrition such a huge problem for so long. A lot of kids that are growing up, they're not fed nutrients like they're supposed to have. They don't have the good essential fatty acids coming in their diet. We're talking malnutrition can cause brain imbalance. You don't get the vitamins and minerals you need. You don't have oils making the brain and function like it's supposed to. Everyone's heard of the problem ADD, ADHD. Kids have a hard time focusing. Well, it can lead to other issues. Amy is obviously chemically imbalanced in decision making, but you know, this has to do with possibly how she's being raised. There's a lot of factors into it, but malnutrition a lot of times plays a lot of parts in decisions.
She looked malnutrition to me. You see her on Celebrity Rehab with those double D's. Please.
She didn't have those at the time.
No, she didn't.
Right, that's what I'm saying.
She bought them.
So, right, that's what I'm saying. But he's talking about when she was younger and was on your porch. It could have been all about,
she looked very healthy to me. I believe she definitely is a victim of sexual abuse as a child. There's no question about it.
Right.
And does she have a chemical imbalance? There's no question about it. She's a narcissist. She's a very sick person, but she has thrived in her own way through society. She got married. She has three kids. She thinks that she's a victim, that everybody, the media has portrayed her to be this horrible, horrible person. What? I'm a really good person. And she's played this game for 19 years now. And you can watch her on Celebrity Rehab.
Right. And we're going to get into that. We're going to get into that. Miss Peaches.
Yeah, Cogee.
Come on in. Come on.
Okay. Well, I just have to say that when you referred to the pistol as a sex pistol, I fell out of my chair, okay?
Yeah. Because I'm going to tell you why. No. Because I'm going to tell you why. Because it goes back to what she said. And we see us all the time that, I mean, women can basically get what they want to get. She knew in her mind already she needed that pistol at whatever cost, right?
Cogee, okay, Peaches, right. Both of you. How do you buy a gun and go up to a strange person at their home?
You're right.
And,
that ain't...
you know, there's one thing, say she thought about it and then she changed her mind and she got scared. I turned away. She pulled the gun out, aimed it at my head, and pulled the trigger.
Right.
This is a very, very sick girl.
Right. So that's what I'm saying. With her going to do that, she put everything on the line, her morals, everything to get this gun. That's why I said, wow, she really went and got her sex pistol. What I was saying was, it wasn't far as a joke.
I didn't enjoy it.
Right. Look. Oh, we gotta keep it clean on here. We gotta keep it clean. But anyway, like I said, jump back on the show. Let's jump right back into it real quick. But like I said, as far as a sex pistol, all I was saying was she put her morals. She didn't care about herself. She did anything
to
get that gun
to
do something wrong. You know what I'm saying? People go to any lengths to do some crazy stuff.
And that shows she should have paid so much harder for what she did. Yeah,
and the guy she got the gun from.
Yeah.
He was a part of that whole situation.
That's right, because hey, you know, we see it every day, Cogee, in the news and everything. Age really doesn't matter right now with the psycho lostness of our youth, because that's what they see. They see it on TV. They see it in their home. And right. youth really does not play so much of a part anymore.
Right, but it also goes back to what I always say on our pedophile show. That's why it's great to start being so much revenge, because it's like, you let this person shoot me and he's in court and y'all just let him get off and walk. It done devastated my home. It done changed my whole family life. I done lost everything and y'all, oh no, no, no. But it also goes back to what I said earlier about the woman smacking the man. You just better know who you do that to. You know what I'm saying? Because some people are going to put it all on the line also because they feel like I done lost everything. And that's what I want to ask you. You was at that point, like you said, when you wanted to kill yourself, you and your kids, you was at that vigilante point in your head to where you was crazy, caught up in the moment, and you felt like, hey, all goes right now, right or wrong.
Right, but I didn't do it because there's something
no,
in
I'm
your
glad
brain.
You didn't, but
that
what I'm saying is, but somebody else would have took it in a different direction.
Well,
everybody wouldn't look at it as rational as you did. Because I'm talking about the court system right now, because of the way that, like you said the court system plays with people. They move them in and move them out like cattle, right or wrong.
Right.
That's what you said.
Yes.
But everybody ain't going to accept that. You know, like, wow, they done me dirty like that, and then they
going
to walk.
What's going on in Washington now? What are we going to do about it?
Yeah, you're right. I mean, but this is what I'm saying. My point is they need to get the system, the court system right and everything right, because that's why a lot of vigilante stuff is going to start happening. I'm just saying, because people don't have the money to fight the court case against somebody who shot you, who might have money with a good attorney, you know. Right. So that's what I'm saying.
Spend all your money and still not get the conviction.
Right. Still not get justice.
Yeah, Cogee, it goes back to our hands off our children. Where did Mary Jo say that it all stemmed from? Her mind was messed up from childhood.
Yeah.
From what? A pedophile.
Right.
Right.
That's right. That's exactly right.
Oh, yeah. So, Ron.
Yeah.
Yeah. Give us your websites and give us everything real quick. We coming down to minutes.
You know, you can reach me at pureformlabs.com. It's a nutritional supplement company that we try to get everyone healthy and well-balanced, because we know a lot of people don't have the time to eat properly like we should here in America. Pretty obvious nowadays about the way everyone looks and all the disease and, you know, we're all living with, and cancer rising like it is. So, yeah, unfortunately, it plays with the brain, it plays with the body, and it plays with disease. So our whole deal in this part of the earth is trying to get everyone educated about proper health through diet and nutrition. So, you know, everyone needs to get those nutrients in, make sure they're healthy and well. I also have stores here in Las Vegas for people who want a one-on-one consultation. We do it for free. Our deal is just to help make a little bit of difference we can.
Right. Okay. Well, hey, we thank you for that, man. You know, I'll be seeing you soon so we can talk. But I appreciate you bringing that knowledge, man, letting people know, hey, diet.
Thanks again for bringing good information to us, Cogee. This is incredible. I've heard this story for a long time, and it's always interesting every time I hear it, you know, from her even once again. So thanks a lot, buddy.
Okay, thanks a lot, man. You take it easy. All right, Big Blaze, hurry up.
I wanted to just definitely comment on what Ron said about it being a chemical imbalance, which you grow up with. I mean, you look at bipolar disorder, you look at narcissism, you look at all the things that they diagnose in hospitals.
Right.
All of these things start with an early age.
That's true.
And I have to say, diet does play a large role in that. We're talking about inherited traits here.
Right.
These people, you know what I mean, if their parents are both bipolar, there's a good possibility they're bipolar.
Right.
If their parents are intense, impulsive, you know, narcissistic, there's a good possibility if they encounter something in their life, they're going to be the same way.
Well, I want us to help people start eating broccoli and carrots and not be encouraged to come and shoot people. We don't want nobody not eating their broccoli and carrots and coming to shoot people. Right,
yeah,
Mary Jo?
Right.
You know what I'm saying? So let's do what you need to do for your kids, man, to help them be mentally stable as well as physically stable. But Mary Jo, one thing I want to say to you is that in this book, your book, Getting It Through My Thick Skull, you went there on that one.
You know,
you put the comedy.
Why did you stay? And I explain in the book why I stayed and what I learned, and all of it, this whole life story of mine has to do with that. I realized that Joe is a sociopath, and the kind that Donna was talking about earlier, the con artist, the charmer, the outgoing. Everybody loves Joey. Everybody who met Joe loved Joey.
Yeah.
When this happened to me, our neighborhood rallied around Joe.
He's a celebrity.
Oh, but they rallied around him because he said, I love Mary Jo. I would never do this. And everybody believed him.
And he was a celebrity overnight with your tragedy. I know that for a fact. I mean, it was all over the news.
Oh.
But you know what? Now, we're talking about your book, but I want to jump to this real quick, and we're going to go back to your book. What about Amy Fisher on Dr. Drew?
Oh.
Now, she's a celebrity right now. They're making her a celebrity for shooting you.
That is just terrible, because the message, again, to the young people, who watches VH1?
It's the wrong message again.
Okay, who watches VH1?
Right, it's the wrong message again. You're right.
That this girl is famous because she almost murdered somebody. And we are now saying, and Dr. Drew, who supposed, I like this guy. I mean, supposedly is an accredited psychologist, doctor, whatever the heck he is. He, I guess they had to dig so far down in the barrel that they had to come up with this person.
Right.
And she's on this show now. It's been going on all summer. It was filmed months ago. My family and I have had such a hard time. I can't, I watched the first 2 weeks and it destroyed me. I drank myself into a depression.
Oh, wow.
My son is crying with me on the phone. My daughter is crying because this is, we had to live this. And we're watching her parade around with her little breasts hanging out. Oh, this is terrestrial radio. I got to be quiet. And the short shorts and the makeup. I mean, she looks like a porn star. She is a porn star, but she looks like it on the show. And to her, this is a game. This is all fun and games. And she got paid a
And any, any, and that's what I was going to say. Any residuals or anything she got, she ain't gave you a peace envelope, a love envelope, a forgive me envelope, or nothing.
Nope. And they paid her a lot of money. And guess what? She did it. And she's doing it. And now she's on. And she's the couple of weeks we watched, she plays the victim like nobody's business. You know, this was almost 20 years ago. You'd think she would have grown up and said, man, I did something so horrible when I was a kid. But she... In her mind, she's definitely buried this this trauma, and I understand it. But nobody is helping her. Nobody,
right? Everybody's they milking the cow right now.
Yeah.
They just getting the money from.
And I'm really surprised,
like you said,
with Drew
the
Pinsky.
Double D's and everything else. They just putting on TV, getting the ratings up. It's all about the money and not about you. But see, the good thing about it is that you got me, you got other people, other stations you go on, and we keep your situation alive. You get what I'm saying?
I do. And certainly, I don't envy her. I don't say, oh, how come I'm not that? I've got my own life. I travel. I speak to college students about, you know, the toxic behaviors. Yes, I belong to an organization called campusspeak.com. Okay. You can check it out. I'm one of many featured speakers there that if colleges want to hire me, I come and I talk to the students, because it's very important. They're at that young age where they're going to get into relationships and they have to learn the difference between a toxic relationship and healthy relationship, so they don't go through all this and bring children into the world and, you know, mess up the next generation. It's
right.
Very important.
And I want to tell you, not only are you beautiful in person, but you're very gorgeous on the book also.
A lot of airbrushing.
Everybody.
Yeah,
you know what? No.
I was going to say that. I was like, you know, I didn't recognize her when she first sat next to me, but as I looked at her, I was like, oh, okay.
Right,
she done changed up.
Yeah,
she
but hers in a ponytail. Yeah.
Well,
yeah.
It's 100 degrees outside.
Right. Yeah, you look good.
Thank you.
Right, and you have remarried since then. We got to do this real quick.
Yes,
come on, short time.
My darling man, Stu. I have a wonderful life here in Henderson.
Oh, okay.
Been here for 2 years now,
and
we've been together 9 years, and it's everything I wanted in my first marriage that I never got. I know the difference now.
Well, like I said, we want to thank you for being on the show today. Let everybody know, fast as you can, where can they get the book?
Getting It Through My Thick Skull. You can order it at Amazon.com or any of the bookstores, or you can go to my website, which is MaryJoButAfuco.com. And if you don't know how to spell it, promise you, put it in, you'll Google it, you'll find it. I'm there. There's pages and pages.
Okay, well, we want to thank you today.
Thank you so much for having me.
We do appreciate it.
I
and like I said, you coming back, because I'm going to talk to you
about
something.
Oh, my goodness.
Else.
I could be your co-host.
Hey, we here. I got you. You all mine.
Okay.
I got you. Okay, well, hey, everybody, on behalf of Conversations with Cogee, it's been a great show today. I hope it's been very informational for you. Hey, these stories are real. These stories are not to be betrayed and be done. These stories are a thing of the past that justice has came to them. Our justice is dealing with it right now. So let's just try to be good people. Let's try to be straight. And we all are working on each other right now. We all are working on ourselves. You know what I'm saying? Nobody know it all out here. We all learning every day. That's right. Life is a journey, just like she said. So like I said, on behalf of Conversations with Cogee, I do this show for y'all like it's my last show. You know what I'm saying? So much love to y'all. And like I said, I want y'all to keep your head up, watching roads out there. Be careful, be cautious. Hey, but don't stop loving. All right? Much love. This is Cogee, baby. Y'all take it easy.
You have now been listening. listening to Conversations with Cogee. Check out the conversationswithcogee.com website. Check out past shows, upcoming events. Check me out every Monday at this same time. Pray for me and stay for me. You dig?